the longest time, the Oppo Find lineup has been more about finding innovation than restraint. I mean, the Find 7 wowed many of us with its specs and quad HD display for the time. The Find X was, well, crazy. It took design and motorized cameras more seriously than any other. And then the Find X2 Pro didn't just go periscopic, but also taught the new kids how to do it in a compact body. There's never been anything conventional about them, so of course it creates this sort of expectation of another Vanguard phone for 2021. Well, this is the Find X3 Pro, what Oppo dubs as the billion color phone and what I'm gonna call one of the sleekest and best looking phones of the year so far, but not necessarily what I'd call a successor to what made the brand popular. So yeah, it's not crazy, there's no wow factor, but if refinement was the intent, there is a lot of that here. I'm Jaime Rivera with Pocket Now, and let's dive into our review. I know, I saw the leaks, and sure, I also thought it looked a lot like an iPhone, but I think that's a huge oversimplification. See, usually smartphones in this category are large and chunky just to fill all their hardware, but this is probably the thinnest and lightest flagship that I've tried yet. To provide some context, it's just 193 grams, making it around 35 to 36 grams lighter than the 12 Pro Max and the S21 Ultra respectively. It's also just 8.2 millimeters thick, leaving the Ultra trailing behind at 8.9, though the 7.4 millimeters on the iPhone is hard to catch up with. I don't usually make a big deal about these things, but because the body is narrower than average, somehow the weight distribution makes this phone feel almost hollow and effortless to use. Now, it does seem like if 2021 is the year of the contour camera, but this is a very different approach. There's a whole scientific explanation into how it takes 40 hours and more than 100 processes to create this kind of a curve, and I like it. It's more cohesive and helps prevent lint from being stuck in the corners. If anything, I'd say the curves make the hump look larger than it is because it doesn't really protrude that much. It is elegant, I'll give you that, but that's as long as you can keep it clean. I might even recommend that you go for the blue option instead of this gloss black color that doesn't do well in that department. Also, I don't have a specific rating for the back, but I do know that the front is Gorilla Glass 5. Now, the whole claim for the billion colors starts with this display. Last year's Find X2 Pro was my favorite display on a phone, edging out every competitor in contrast ratio, and the legacy continues here. This is a stunning 6.7 inch quad HD OLED capable of 10-bit color, 100% of the DCI-P3 color gamut, HDR10+, 1300 nits of brightness, and the same 5,000,000:1 contrast ratio from last year. Colors, brightness, and viewing angles are seriously fantastic, and because it's LTPO, you also have variable refresh rate between 5 and 120 Hz at more power efficiency and 240 Hz touch sampling. Match this with tiny and symmetrical bezels allowing for 92.7% screen to body ratio and a good pair of dual firing speakers.
The Galaxy is visually larger than the Max, but
Content consumption is great. There's also a very fast but not as reliable face to unlock through the punch hole camera, and the optical fingerprint scanner at the very bottom of the display just makes it easier for you to be able to unlock this phone while wearing a mask. Internals are also that of a typical high-end flagship. We have the latest Qualcomm Snapdragon 888, 12 gigs of RAM, 256 gigs of non-expandable storage, dual SIM 5G that supports all flavors, the latest Wi-Fi and Bluetooth, a large 4500 mAh battery, VOOC rapid charging up to 65 watts, and yes, it comes in the box, and finally, some wireless charging up to 30 watts if you have Air VOOC, which is optional. And yes, it is also reversible up to 10 watts, and for those of you worried, it is IP68 water and dust resistant as well. This is ColorOS 11.2 running on top of Android 11, which sure is not stock Android, but not really far from it. the UI elements are still mostly Oppo, but the more you use it, the more you realize just how Googleified it is. You have the Google feed to the left of the launcher, there's an option to call on the Google Assistant, even from the power button, and you can also set an application tray if that's your jam. Other features are actually welcome, like using your fingerprint to unlock your private safe or specific applications, in addition to calling shortcuts with a gesture. There's a side menu for quick shortcuts and other enhancements like game space and what Oppo dubs their Relax 2.0. Really, all you care about is that the UI doesn't bog down the experience, and that's the case here. Apps launch fast, animations are minor, so it all feels smooth, and as a result, I feel that battery life is pretty good. After a week of testing on Google Fi, I've been able to end my days with enough of a charge left, no overheating, though even with all the 5G antennas included, I can't say that I got 5G to work. Fi is still finicky about the phones it supports with it, even leaving iPhones off the list, so I'll attribute that to being my problem. Now, let's talk cameras for a bit, because that's another reason for the billion color tagline. Oppo and Sony co-engineered a new 50-megapixel IMX766 sensor that's capable of 10-bit color, but this is actually the first phone to include two of them, one in the primary camera and the other in the ultra-wide. This makes a lot of sense because if you think about it, in a mirrorless camera, you can change the lenses to provide a different focal length, but the image quality is never affected because the sensor doesn't change. I wish that were the case with the telephoto, which actually took a step back from being periscopic. I'll let the results do the talking, and then we'll discuss the fourth camera that's being included here in a bit. At first, I thought that they just looked great because the display made them look good, but once you pull them into a computer, the results actually remain pretty consistent. As expected, daylight photos are great, but Oppo is playing with a bit more contrast in its color science, creating this sort of like Leica grain that I'm really liking. It makes colors like red look bolder and more elegant, and it plays in its favor mostly when switching focal lengths because since you're losing aperture on the other cameras, the grain sort of compensates for the loss in detail in the shadows. And then having the same sensor on the ultra-wide leads to color consistency, and even if there is one less element on the lens, there is nearly no distortion on the sides. And sure, we lost the periscopic zoom lens, but I'd say photos even up to 5x hybrid are really good, though I do suggest you stay away from the 20x digital. Seriously, it's bad. In low light, I'd say this phone performs better than most. These would be the only ultra-wide photos I'd ever recommend at night, providing results that are almost on par with the primary. Obviously, the darker it gets, the harder it is given the differences in aperture, but I'm very impressed overall. It's not until you jump into the telephoto that things start falling apart, but that's the story with pretty much every other phone. Oddly, I am a fan of the selfies, but not of the selfie portraits. Somehow the latter needs some serious tuning, as all dynamic range is blown off in most cases, something every other competing phone solved generations ago, I'd say. And sadly, it is the same way that I feel about video. I mean, the back camera can go up to 4K at 60, providing some decent results with good stabilization and colors, but I'm gonna apologize right now for the selfie video footage. There's no stabilization, pretty regular dynamic range, and it's still stuck at 1080p, which again is something that competitors addressed ages ago. As for camera number 4, well, this is a micro lens that Oppo dubs its microscope that allows up to 60x magnification and even records full HD video of, the weave that makes up my mouse pad. It uses a circular ring light to help you get really close to your subject, but aside from learning that my hankies were not really made of 100% cotton, this is more of a gimmick given the low resolution of the results. I mean, it's nice, but not really something I feel you'll use more than once. To conclude, I think the best way to summarize the Oppo Find X3 Pro is by calling it the most mature flagship in its lineup. I mean, sure, the wow factor is gone, but I think it was done with a purpose. During our briefing, we asked why features like the periscopic lens were taken away, and the engineers claimed that users didn't use it as much as the primary or the ultrawide. It kind of makes sense, for complexity to be removed if its added value is pretty much underutilized. Maybe the reason why I disagree with that particular approach is because I feel that the industry needs phones like the ones this lineup used to stand for. Not all features will stick around for an extra year or two, but the only way to live in the future is through experimentation. If it wasn't for those motorized cameras or periscopic lenses, I don't think other manufacturers would have adopted the technology, so it's proof that Oppo was actually delivering on useful ideas and not the usual gimmicks we get from other companies most of the time. Now, in all fairness, if I were to judge the Find X3 Pro as a flagship, it's a great phone. From the look, to the feel of the hardware, to the experience with the software, it is a joy to use. If photography is your thing, this is one of the best phones on my list, even if I wish all my needs for video were addressed. Sure, I was expecting a bit more than just a flagship with this phone, but that doesn't deter from the fact that I have no problem at all in recommending it just the way it is. Now, let us know what you think about the Oppo Find X3 Pro in the comments down below, and while you're at it, follow us on social media, subscribe to our channel for more videos like this one, and you can also follow me on my personal handles to see me clean this phone repeatedly and find crazy ways to film it. Because, anyways, please give this video a thumbs up if you like what you saw. I'm Jaime Rivera. Thanks so much for watching. We'll see you on the next one.